Today we're talking Brexit, because despite the fact that this story is more than 2 years old at this point, it's definitely going through its terrible twos. And boy are they terrible.
British Prime Minister Theresa May, just in the last couple of minutes, talking, of course, about Brexit. That Parliament session is still going on as Theresa May deals with a huge shakeup inside her cabinet. We're talking about British Foreign Secretary Boris Johnson resigning. He is now the third high-level official in the UK to just walk out in the last 24 hours.
He can't be too surprised, though. I mean, Britain isn't particularly good at leaving, just as India or the 13 colonies. 2 years in, though, what is suddenly happening? And why would this issue all of a sudden lead to three high-ranking government officials suddenly thinking, well, it's been 2 years and a month, now is the perfect time to take a stand. Everyone's watching. Oh wait, Trump's coming to Europe and meeting with Putin? Can I resubmit my resume for a seasonal position and quit in September? Well, the problem is that after literal years of debate that's been eerily reminiscent to the debate at your Thanksgiving dinner, and if you think I'm kidding, here's a Scottish MP rapping in Parliament about Brexit, and summarizing up the current problems pretty well.
BREXIT, fed up with Brexit, me three. Trading relations, heading down the Swanee. If it doesn't fit on the side of a bus, let's not say it, don't make a fuss. Phase one was a floundering mess, the Prime Minister said she did her best. The Irish border was the sticking point, and the DUP, cross-border trade, we're told it's possible. It's about wording, you see.
Man, do I want to see MC McConnell break it down about immigration and border security. Ice, ice, baby. It went on for another few minutes and indicated all the problems we're talking about today. A quickly approaching deadline, an Irish border, and businesses worried about trade. All of these factors led to this report, reported 2 days before all the ministers quit.
Going in, the government was split between those largely on the right of the Conservative Party demanding a so-called hard Brexit and those loyal to the Prime Minister looking for a softer divorce deal with the EU. Some 10 hours later, the conclave dispersed and the Prime Minister emerged, an agreement reached.
What they agreed on was a soft Brexit. You know, just a touch of Brexit here and there. Basically the geopolitical equivalent of, I think we should see other people, but we should still be friends. Basically, what they agreed on was Britain would sign up for Europe's rules for manufactured goods, food, and other farm produce without being able to shape them. You know, independence. In the same way that your parents won't let you put a lock on the door, but they promise to knock before entering. So, why do this? I mean, you're out, you can do what you want. Wave to those regulations in the rearview mirror. Well,
at the core of Friday's agreement is the establishment of a free trade area for goods, avoiding the need for a return to customs checks on the border between Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland.
Leave it to Ireland to make this as confusing as possible, because while Northern Ireland is a part of the United Kingdom, the Republic of Ireland is still in the EU. Yeah, it gets almost stroke-inducingly complicated to talk about when you say that about 5/6 of Ireland is an independent Ireland. But if you don't smell burnt toast, stick around. Basically, because of this, if Northern Ireland and Irish Ireland were abiding by two different trade standards, well, that would just be unnecessarily confusing. And it would force Great Britain to open up customs and border regulation on their border with Ireland. Which would be great to just not have to do. This accepting of international standards only extends to physical goods though, because services like banking and finance would be dealt with under a separate framework that would give Britain much more flexibility to set its own regulations. Do you want to know the scary thing? Whoop, what I just told you? Yeah, that little trade resolution thing? Well, that took more than 2 years for the government to figure out. Congress, please forgive me for all the jokes I've made. You guys are breaking land speed records compared to the UK. So this led to...
Well, this is the most significant document to be released in the past 2 years since the UK's referendum that voted to leave the EU.
This white paper was just what we talked about written down, because the original version from the meeting had scribbles from Boris Johnson's crayon all over it. So let's take a step back. I mean, again, it's been 2 years. What finally rallied the British? Did they finally finish all the easy tasks on their list of things to do? Well, no. It turns out that the problem was much more something that a college student can relate to.
We're very clear. We will be leaving the EU on the 29th of March, 2019 at 11 p.m.
Oh, God! You know that writing assignment that was assigned to us 2 years ago to do? It's due coming up. Some MPs are pushing for an extension, but it seems like you're just gonna have to pound some Monster Energy drinks and hammer this stuff out. So, alright, we've got the British White Paper. What does it say? Well, I went right to the source, and boy did they pad this thing. I mean, chapter 1 starts on page 17, after blank pages and forwards from anyone the government could get their hands on to write a testimonial. So what does it say? Well, first, as we talked about earlier, they want to establish a new free trade area and maintain a common rulebook for goods. You know, so that way if Trump boycotts Britain because someone explained to him what happened over the Revolutionary War, they'll still have trading partners. Again though, this would include new arrangements on services and investments that provide regulatory flexibility. Because UK banks didn't become some of the most powerful banks in the world by being regulated. Instead, they got there by being major contributors and major market collapses. Hey, a sinking tide hurts all competition. Now, there are some new things in here we haven't mentioned. This is something I probably wouldn't have noticed even a few months ago, but the UK is asking for the phased introduction of a new facilitated customs arrangement, which would enable the UK to control its own tariffs for trade with the rest of the world. Alright, I realize that's a lot of words, and most of those words are incredibly long and boring. I mean, the term facilitated customs arrangement might be a more powerful sedative than elephant tranquilizers. This is actually a crazy controversial thing that most people think will stir up major problems when the UK actually starts negotiating these terms. Basically, the UK wants to be in charge of collecting all of the tariff money for imports into the EU. Which, according to one person close to cabinet discussions, that's right, here at That's All We Have to Say About That, we only get the best sources. It would be like the Chancellor giving Iceland the power to collect tax revenue on our behalf. We'd have no way of ensuring it was enforced properly. Man, if the trade war heats up anymore, you'd be in a really good position. Please don't start sending our President RT tweets, though. This collection portion is somewhat weak in its grounding though, because if you were to ask, why should a non-EU country be collecting all of the tariffs for all of the EU countries? Well, the answer is simple. This, the UK government believes, would go some way to preserving the open Irish border, as there would be no need for customs checks on the UK-EU border. Well, as compelling as not needing customs on your Irish border, I'm not sure that group you've just abandoned will be too sympathetic to that cause. Next we see, end free movement, giving the UK back control over how many people come to live in the UK. You see, this EU is governed by this thing called the Schengen Agreement.
The Schengen Agreement, an arrangement that allows the free movement of European citizens between 26 countries across the continent.
Yes, that. It's great for refugees looking to travel from the struggling countries they've landed in to more successful inland countries, and guys who are always putting off their visas until the last second. You don't need documents to travel between countries in the EU. Now, Britain was not a participant in that Schengen Agreement from the beginning, but they did participate in a program that allowed all EU citizens to have a right to live, work, and travel amongst the bloc. Which has raised some problems, because, well, the EU isn't the exclusive club it once was. Yeah, I think it's a safe bet more people are leaving Bulgaria than entering. This white paper does say that the UK government wants to negotiate reciprocal mobility agreements, suggesting that the EU citizens would be given preferential treatment in a future immigration system. Lastly, we see that the UK would maintain a common rulebook with the EU, including the Union Customs Code and rules related to safety and security, and would apply and interpret those rules consistently with the EU. Again, that might sound like one of the most mundane things to lose your mind over, but that's huge. It means that the European Court of Justice still has final say in a lot of UK laws relating to customs, safety, and security. And furthermore, now they're out. The UK won't even have a say in what the European Court of Justice thinks. So, sorry again, Britain, that the EU won't let you put a lock on your door. But at least they'll knock. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hey YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan comedy news, remember to subscribe by clicking right here, or do it the old-fashioned way and click down below. As always, give me a thumbs up, and thank you for watching.